Hey everyone, Sam from Professional Music Technology here, and in this video we're going to be explaining the differences between the most common types of effects pedals that are used with the bass guitar. Now before we dive in, it is definitely worth mentioning that even though most of the pedals that we'll be featuring here today have been specifically designed and optimised for use with the lower frequencies of a bass guitar, there are literally thousands of other effects out there, and a lot of these, especially overdrives and fuzz pedals, will sound just as good on a bass as they do on a six-string guitar. So just in case you didn't already know, as a bassist, you're not just limited to the pedals that say bass on them, and plugging a bass into a standard guitar effects pedal won't cause it any damage. So it's definitely worth experimenting with a few effects that you might never have thought of using with a bass. Why should guitarists have all the fun? So let's get into it. So the first couple of pedals that we're going to be taking a look at fall under the category of what's known as dynamic effects. So that's compressors, limiters and EQ pedals. As effects pedals go, these are less about dramatically altering the sound of a bass, but they are really important for shaping your core tone. So this type of pedal will usually go at the front of your signal chain before any other effects. The most common type of dynamic effect used on a bass is probably a compressor pedal, and this does exactly as its name suggests. It compresses and squeezes your bass's output signal to make it a more consistent volume, so quieter notes will become louder and the volume of harder playing is brought down. A bass limiter does a similar thing, but instead of compressing the signal, it will just put a ceiling on the output volume, so it's pulling down any really loud spikes that exceed the volume threshold that you've set. A compressor's controls are just how pronounced and aggressive that squeezing of the signal is, and this can range from very subtle for smoothing out your playing and just adding a little punch to the signal, to much more extreme compression, useful for slap bass playing, giving those slapping and popping notes a much more consistent attack and volume. A graphic EQ is another important pedal in a bass player's arsenal, as they will usually allow for much more detailed control over your tone than you might get from your bass amp's onboard EQ. They work just like the graphic EQ on a hi-fi system, allowing you to boost or cut bass, mid-range or treble frequencies. And as most EQ pedals also have an output volume control, they can also be used as a boost pedal, meaning that you can set an EQ and volume separately from your bass amp to really help you cut through the mix when the pedal's engaged, ideal for any solo sections. Also I've seen some bass effects that are referred to as preamp pedals, which usually encompass all of these dynamic elements, as well as gain and drive controls, something that we'll be covering a little later on. These preamp pedals are designed to be an all-in-one solution for shaping your tone, and whilst they can be used in conjunction with a bass amplifier, they can also replace your amp as your main tone source, as most preamps will have a balanced XLR output and features such as a cab simulator and a ground lift. Now, these features might not sound that exciting to you as a bassist, but your sound engineer will love you for them, as the preamp pedal will allow you to sculpt a really powerful bass tone and send it directly to the mixing desk, either at a gig or in a recording studio, without having to mic up any amplifiers. So for you, this means that you can turn up at any venue and just use the house backline for your onstage sound, but the preamp pedal means that you'll always be able to give a sound engineer your signature bass tone to put through the front of house PA. The next type of effect that we're looking at, which in the signal chain will usually be the next pedal placed after a compressor, is an envelope filter or a wah pedal. Now, strictly speaking, envelope filters, wahs and auto wahs aren't exactly the same thing, but they do give a similar sound, which is based on sweeping through a frequency range, emphasising certain frequencies and cutting others as they go, and they can add some real character to funkier bass lines. With a wah pedal, that frequency sweep is controlled by your foot, which you can rock back and forth to emphasise bassier frequencies at the heel position, sweeping through the mids up to the treblier toe position. So they allow for really expressive and articulate control over that tonal sweep. An auto wah, or an envelope filter on the other hand, responds to your playing dynamics instead. Now, although these will feature controls to adjust the sensitivity, on a whole, lower frequencies will be emphasised by softer playing, sweeping up to the higher frequencies as you start to play more aggressively. So moving on, if you're into heavier music styles, or maybe you just want to add a bit of extra grit to your bass tone, you're probably going to want some sort of drive pedal, either an overdrive, distortion, or fuzz. In terms of signal chain, these will usually be placed after any dynamic pedals, but it's up to you to experiment whether you want to put it before or after a filter or wah effect, as different pedal placements will give you a different result. Whilst offering very different tonal characteristics, an overdrive, distortion or fuzz will usually share one control in common, and that's a gain or drive knob, which is used to gradually overdrive your clean signal to add more distortion. Overdrive pedals use soft clipping circuitry for a smoother, more natural sounding drive, so they're ideal for adding just a little more grunt to your signal for a rockier tone. Distortions utilise hard clipping circuits, so they tend to sound a bit harsher and more in your face, whilst a fuzz pedal, such as the iconic Electro-Harmonics Big Muff, takes this to the extreme, using square wave clipping to heavily saturate and compress your signal, resulting in some truly brutal bass tones.
Mm-hmm.
Another great way of fattening up your bass tone is with a pitch shifting pedal, most commonly an octaver such as the Boss OC3 or the Electro Harmonix POG. Best placed just after your compressor and before any other effects pedals, an octaver will allow you to add an octave below your original note, which can add a really sub-like quality to your tone. And if you add an octave above as well, especially when combined with distortion, it can sound like both a bassist and a guitarist playing at the same time, a technique used by two-piece bands such as Royal Blood and Death From Above. Although they are a little rarer, some bass pitch shifters, such as the Digitech Bass Whammy, take this a step further by allowing you to add harmony notes at intervals other than octaves. And the Whammy also allows you to control the sweep of the pitch with your foot, so you can achieve those kind of electric guitar, floating tremolo style dive bomb effects, which have never really been possible on a bass. So the next category of effects that we're going to be talking about is modulations. Now, in the world of electric guitar effects, there's lots of different types of pedals that fall into this category, such as flangers, tremolos, and vibratos. And as I mentioned earlier, there are no real rules as to what you can experiment with on a bass. But that said, the most common type of modulation effect used with a bass is probably a chorus and, to a lesser extent, a phaser. Usually placed towards the end of your signal chain after any dynamic, pitch and drive effects, a chorus is great for thickening up a tone, making it sound kind of like two bassists playing the same thing at the same time, but slightly out of tune with each other. And this was widely used on bass lines back in the 1980s, but is still popular nowadays with lo-fi indie bands. A phaser modulates the signal in a different way to a chorus, instead shifting the phase and giving it a sweeping, psychedelic-like quality, great for funky 70s-style bass lines. Most chorus and phaser pedals will have controls to adjust the speed and depth of the effect, meaning that whilst you might not have this type of effect engaged all the time, they will offer quite a wide range of tones to play with. Thank you. If you're a fan of more electronic music, you know, dance or hip hop, you might want to check out a bass synthesizer pedal. Now, as opposed to the other pedals that we've looked at here, which manipulate and modify the original tone of your bass, these work by tracking the notes that you're playing, which then trigger the pedal's internal synth engine, meaning that regardless of the type of bass or pickups that you're using, the tone of the effect coming out of the pedal should always sound pretty much the same. They tend to work best without any other pedals before them in the signal chain, so you won't really need to use any compression or EQ, but you can get pretty creative by adding different effects such as modulations, delays and reverbs after a bass synth, especially as pedals such as the Boss SYB5 or Electro-Harmonics Bass Monosynth have a huge range of electronic synth sounds to experiment with, either as a standalone tone generator or mixed in with your dry bass signal to really thicken things up. So I think we've covered most of the common types of effects pedals that bassists tend to use, but if you are into more experimental playing or ambient style music, you might also want to try your bass with a delay or a reverb pedal. Now there's lots of different types of delays and reverbs out there, and you are definitely more likely to find them in the electric guitar department as opposed to the bass section of your local music shop. But as I've said previously about other pedals, although you might not find this type of effect on every bass player's pedal board, they're not exclusively reserved for guitarists. Just in case you were confused, there is quite a big difference between a delay and a reverb. A delay, or echo, takes your signal and echoes back a clear repeat, or a series of repeats, with controls to adjust the delay time and the amount of repeats. A reverb, on the other hand, is a much more kind of washy sounding effect, with no clear repeats or definition of that original signal. So imagine what it would sound like to play your bass nice and loud in a large warehouse or an empty sports hall, with all those sound reflections and reverberations going on. You'll probably want to put these types of pedals at the end of your signal chain, usually the last effect before going into your amplifier. Delays and echoes work really well with a bass guitar at either shorter slapback echo times to add an almost chorusing type effect, or at longer delay times to create rhythmic patterns, which can sound very kind of electronica, especially when combined with a bass synth pedal. Reverb pedals, on the other hand, can help to add a much more ambient and atmospheric vibe to your playing, and they can be really useful for building up epic intros and interludes between songs. And there's definitely no reason why you can't combine both a delay with a reverb. Before we finish, one thing that I haven't mentioned yet are multi-effects pedals. So far, to keep things simple, we've only looked at individual pedals offering a single type of effect. But if you did want to experiment with all of the different types of effects that we've talked about, but you don't want to spend a fortune on lots of individual pedals or have to worry about how you're going to connect them all up, a multi-effects unit might be the way to go. Multi-effects units such as the Boss GT1B have been specifically designed for bass guitars and offer a wide range of effects such as compressors, filters, drive, synth, modulation, delays and reverbs, plus a built-in expression pedal for wah and pitch shift effects and an onboard tuner. You might not get all of the tweakability and unique tones of individual stomp boxes, but you do get a much more compact, portable layout packed with features at a much more affordable price, considering all it's got to offer.
Thank you.
So there we go. That was our beginner's guide to bass guitar effects. So now you know what each type of pedal does, I do urge you to get down to your nearest PMT store and get experimenting with a few of these for yourself. Obviously, if you are building a pedal board, there are a couple of essential pedals that we've not covered here, mainly a tuner and a looper. Looper pedals in particular are a great practice tool, but I wouldn't strictly call them an effects pedal. So if you did want to find out more about those, definitely go and check out our loop pedal buying guide video. So thanks for watching. For more information on any of the bass effects that you've seen here, visit pmtonline.co.uk. And as always, don't forget to follow us on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram as PMT House of Rock. If you enjoyed this video and found it helpful, please do give it a thumbs up and don't forget to hit that subscribe button and ring the notifications bell so you never miss a video. Thanks again, I'll see you soon.